BAM is a communications agency that believes stories move the world. We move stories forward for technology-driven brands that challenge, change, and create entire industries. Today, we have Amy Lin, Director of Marketing at Capital RX, on the show. She oversees brand content, PR, product marketing, and demand generation at Capital RX. Earlier in her career, she worked on international market entry strategies at Ralph Lauren. In her spare time, Amy enjoys traveling and salsa dancing. Let's dive in.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Dear Banff, the podcast for PR and marketing pros such as yourself. Thanks for listening today. Today, we have Amy Lin, who's the director of marketing at CapRx that you guys all just heard about. Thank you for being here, Amy.
Thank you so much for having me. Very excited to be here.
Yes, and we have quite a handful of questions, so let's get to it. Here we go. First one up. Dear Banff, we're gearing up for a big customer announcement as well as a funding announcement for one of my clients, yet we just caught wind that the CEO and founder is stepping down. He's leaving on fairly good terms and remaining involved in a different capacity, but I want to make sure we handle the announcements appropriately to avoid any backlash about this major executive team change. What should I do now to prepare? Amy.
So sometimes changing CEOs is part of the company's natural progression, especially in the startup world. Companies evolve and grow so fast, and different stages need different leadership. And there's no exception to the role of the CEO. So it's really just business. But whenever there's a change at the very top, people tend to guess, is there any kind of drama behind the scene? So I remember a few years back, the founder of ClassPass stepped down as the CEO, but took on the role of the executive chairman. The press release was very clear about the plan, the transition, and the reasoning behind it. But if you look at the media headlines in that round of coverage, most of them just said the founder is stepping down.
Yeah, which is like,
Yeah. So it is to be expected that a lot of people are going to interpret it in their own way. And I feel like typically for media, they're very quick to report perceived corporate instability.
Yes.
And raise questions about the performance of the CEO and the company. So two things are very important here. I think number one is to have a very proactive media outreach, to have very concise and accurate messaging to convey why the transitioning is happening right now. How is this CEO going to be involved and to what extent? Who is going to take over as the interim CEO or the next CEO? And how is this all going to influence the direction of the company? I would also suggest doing under embargo. So you can pre-brief some reporters that you really trust and have built a great relationship with to secure a more holistic or more accurate story at the outset of the announcement. So when the press release comes out, there will be a couple of positive or accurate stories that you can point to help set the tone for that round of media coverage. That's number one. Number two, I would say, try to address the question of, are the CEO and the company underperforming head on? So it's great for this question that they have the announcements of the customer and the funding next.
Which are two positives.
Yeah. So those are very strong evidence that the company is doing well. So if I could, I would actually package all three announcements together.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. And the change of the CEO is kind of not buried, but is secondary to these great things.
Exactly. It makes people feel that it's part of the plan. And it's part of the direction of the company going into the next phase, and also kind of indicating that the CEO is leaving on good terms.
Yeah, it does say fairly good terms. I'm kind of curious about what fairly is, but that's okay. We're going to take it with positivity. I completely agree with you, Amy, on this. How nice is it that you have two solid, positive pieces of news and the heads up about this so that you can roll it all into one entire packaged story, ideally. To your earlier point, I would definitely ensure and tie up the plan of, well, who's the interim CEO, or is there already someone else who's coming in? What will this person's role be? Are they sitting on the board now? Are they going to retire? Are they, you know, what all exactly that is so that you're fully prepared? Because not just having like, oh, by the way, the CEO stepping down, but then nothing else leads to too much of, you know, dot, dot, dot. What does this all mean?
Exactly.
If in a perfect world, you can get all those dot, dot, dot figured out, interim plan. Oh, he's going to be on the board. She's going to be on the board, whoever it is. Perfect. I really think in this case that this can be shown as the natural progression of a thriving startup company. More funding, more big partnerships. We don't know from here. Oh, it does say the CEO and founder. So this is sometimes the evolution of the founder story. They build it to a certain size and then they step away and they bring in the quote unquote, the suits in a sense, or the executives who run much bigger companies. And then they go off to fund their next thing. I don't think this one is too horrible.
Yeah, exactly. And tying back to the ClassPass story, now, you know, they have the time to really demonstrate to the general public that it is part of their plan and the founder is just taking on a more strategic direction. So sometimes you have to leave it to the time to tell.
Yes, very true.
For the part that you can really control, try to influence the narrative as much as possible by providing a lot of evidence and a lot of facts to support your statement.
Mm-hmm. One last thing too, this should be obvious, but just to mention this, is that the CEO's commentary or the letter or whatever that's going to be coming out from this person is also going to be key in this. So that it is on good terms, there is acknowledgement of the journey or whatever you want to call it. And it's that. I think sometimes companies get on the back foot when, oh, CEO's been ousted. Mm-hmm. Never hear from that person again. You know, there's no comment, there's no quotes, and it seems like something bad went down. So again, time is on this person's side here for the writer who wrote in. And if you can get that involved and have the CEO ready and prepared with all the statements and acknowledgements and all that good stuff, I think this person's in a good spot.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, let's get to our next one here. Dear Banff, okay, my client just signed a deal for half their business to get acquired, half their business to get acquired by a major company in Italy in order for the Italian company to foster a presence in the US. The Italian company wants to announce the acquisition next week, yet we hardly have any details about what the new brand will look like and how my client will handle the reorg. How do I handle announcements with little to no info?
Next week is very tight.
Yeah, that I was going to say, I don't like this.
Even though PR is a fast-paced field, there's a lot of planning to do before a major announcement like this. The most ideal scenario is to get a seat at the table in the early stage of the deal-making process. But the reality is most of the deals team are composed of a lot of finance people and attorneys.
Yeah.
And they tend to focus on the deal terms, the paperwork,
and trying to
not make any kind of mistakes. Yeah, exactly. So PR doesn't come naturally to them. And even if you try to talk about PR strategies, they may not know exactly what to do next. So what I found helpful in the past, and the easiest and most efficient way to communicate with them, is to come up with a half-established framework with the limited information that you have and just let the team fill in the blanks. Mm. It's kind of like giving them a laundry list so they know exactly what needs to happen and what is exactly needed from their end.
You mean the team, the acquisition team, the executives who are doing this deal?
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
And I would also start crafting a story based on the public track records of the two companies. In every deal announcement, you always try to introduce the two companies. So in this case, the Italian company, mm-hmm. What is their investment philosophy? Are they very much focused on consumer tech or are they more of a consolidator in the traditional retail space?
Mm-hmm.
Is this deal the first one in the U.S., or is this another major milestone for them to solidify their footprint in North America? And then what does this deal mean to the company being acquired? Does the injection of capital will help them turbocharge their growth?
Mm-hmm.
Or is this also part of their plan to utilize the holding company level resources to expand into the European market? So by answering these questions and looking at past announcements and just like their overall deal portfolio, you can get an initial idea and just build that life story, which talks to the past, the present, and the future of these two companies. And then I will leave the information on the specific plan for the brand and reorg as the fill in the blank section. And I think there are potentially several possibilities here. Like one is maybe they haven't fully figured it out yet. You'd be surprised.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like very much like about to close, but they haven't fully figured out everything 100%. Maybe that's why they have very limited information for you. The number two possibility could be there would be an integration process
mm-hmm.
for like the next 6 to 12 months, and then they're going to make a decision. And then the third possibility, which is actually pretty common these days, is the acquired company is going to continue to be independent and maintain some sort of autonomy.
Yes, that's like the Instagram model, quote unquote.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So maybe you can like lay out the different options for the team and just say, you know, whichever option or scenario that we go with, we just need to decide how much information is known and how much information we can share, because that's definitely going to come up when we interact with media. That's definitely going to come up in media interviews. We just wanted to make sure that everyone's aligned on the messaging and the plan.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I would go about it. And I feel like once you establish that, the rest of the checklist is relatively easy.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to finalize who's going to be the spokesperson and determine if he or she needs extensive media training. If this person is less experienced, you probably want to do some role play so they can anticipate the media questions better
mm-hmm.
and have more like natural responses. What do you think, Beck?
Yeah, I agree with the checklist. And that's helpful because a lot of times deal lawyer people are like checkbox people. So they would appreciate that. So that's helpful. The one thing in this question, I'm reading into it, so that might be a little bit too much, but the Italian company wants to announce the acquisition next week. Well, I don't care what you want. Let's talk about what's feasible. So I don't know who, you know, this is the person writing it, it sounds my client. So they're not in the company, but I'm wondering if there's any ability to, from maybe the CMO internal of this company or whoever's at the C-suite level, to say, whoa, whoa, whoa. Yeah, we can ink this deal. We can get the money wired, all that good stuff, or whatever we're doing. But we don't have to, upon the day, come out necessarily and say, how about we buy ourselves a few more days or even weeks? Is that possible? Just because this seems like they're a bit of the aggressor in this. They want to do this. Yeah, of course. Because when you get, when they're the acquirer, it's like, oh, we want to da, da, da. But that then you're already on the defense basically with this. So I don't like that. And I'm wondering if, however you may best have with your client contact, to be able to convey to them, okay, whoa, 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 let's just park the brakes for a second. Maybe there is more time for us to take a beat, put the list together, and come up with a thoughtful approach of how we want to announce this.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of holes. Here's our checklist, for example. See how there's 27 things on this list? Okay. You know what I mean? So that was kind of my clue into this of, perhaps there is a bit more time. And that's always the thing too with like client relations where, oh, we want to do this. We want to do this. Yes, I understand you want to do this. But if our goal is we want to come off together as being strategic, or that we're on a united front, or whatever that goal is, then that can stamp out a want or a desire. Does that make sense? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point. I think it's worth having that discussion and say, you know, if we want to maximize the results and the media coverage and make sure we're fully prepared for such an important deal that everybody has been working for months or maybe even years.
What's the rush?
What's the one? Yeah, the 1 week or 2 weeks going to impact us. So I think that's a great point to buy more time for everybody to better prepare for the media interactions that's coming up. But I do feel like sometimes a lot of the deals teams, they're always in a rush.
they're hyped. They're hyped all the time.
We can do this. We can operate on a 1 week timeline, but there are a million things that we need to check off the list. And these are the things that we really need to align. So based on, you know, your perspective and your interaction with the team, is this realistic? If not, then we can buy another week's time before we officially announce.
Exactly. All right. Next question, Amy. Dear Beth, a new client of mine dealt with a significant negative news cycle right when COVID hit. Although the news cycle has simmered down for the most part, many people have a sour taste in their mouths for the company. That is very ambiguous, inserted my comment there. Okay, now that a few months have passed, what's the best approach to take to start rebuilding their brand rep? Should we go out with a statement about the past, or should we focus our efforts on solidifying our message and company focus in a future thinking way?
Yeah.
Well, we don't know what the negative news cycle is here. So this person's being purposely ambiguous, I'm sure, or otherwise we might be able to suss out what's up. But what do you think, Amy?
Yeah, I was hoping for a little bit more information. But whenever there is negative press, I would always pause first and actually ask questions internally and to myself. Number one is the press coverage true?
Yeah.
And number two is, how bad is the damage? Is this like a national story, a local story? If it's a local story, could it grow into a bigger story? And what is the impact on the brand value in the long term? I mean, that's the two questions I would always ask and investigate. What's your first step?
I would look at kind of a postmortem here. What exactly happened? How did this thing, it sounds like something really ran away here where it blew up for a moment. If you have people that, as this person's saying, have a sour taste in their mouth for the company, okay, clearly this thing spiraled a bit and there's now negative news. This person, this writer is saying, my new client. So, you know, you guys are coming in as probably a third party, which is great. You're not internal to the company. It's difficult to do an assessment necessarily, but maybe your first agenda item here is, hey, let's do an analysis. Let's do a postmortem. How did we get to that time? It started with one story. Okay. And that exploded, or was it one person who leaked something to the press, or were we not on board with the messaging? Like, what happened so that you can avoid such a situation evolving in this, in any future form? So I would do an analysis. And how great, you're a third party. You're coming in like a third party consultant does. Like, this is like what Deloitte does. They come in, they do an assessment, and they're going to look in and kind of dig around. You probably got to do a bunch of interviews, all this good stuff, and really figure out like what happened here.
Yeah.
Once you then know that, you could probably avoid repeating. And now you're going to look like the hero agency to come in and say, hey guys, great. Here's our plan. Here's how now we're not going to have a situation like that evolve.
Yeah, I agree. I feel like asking questions, doing investigation and analysis to see how we've got to this point is the number one step before, you know, strategizing on the next steps. You know, there are also different kinds of negative press coverage. If it's a true crisis, then let's follow the fundamental rules of PR. You take responsibilities, you address the problem, explain to the public how and why it happened. And the last step is to try to come up with a solution to minimize the damage and the negative impact. But there's also negative press that you don't need to correct or pursue or stay on that phase for too long. I feel like for companies who are growing very fast, when they get to a certain point where they're really scaling up and getting a lot of traction in the market, it's very natural for them to attract different kinds of voices.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, people will doubt your numbers, your growth, and even your business model. But, you know, companies are like individuals. We can't make everybody like us. So that's normal. Another kind of negative press is more people trying to create stories out of nothing.
The haters.
Yeah, yeah. And just trying to get views or drive traffic to the website. So I feel like for the last two categories of negative press, you don't need to pursue any kind of correction or argue against it, because the more attention you give to them, the more meaning and significance you give to those untrue or unfair press coverage. Mm-hmm. So I think it's also very important to determine the nature of the negative press. Is this a true crisis or is it just noise?
Yeah, we can't fully tell too from the question. They say, should we go out with a statement about the past? Now, we don't know about that. But to your point, Amy, yeah, what type, what categorization of coverage was this? And there is, as we know, and we don't know if this is a startup, but that's a lot of the questions we get from folks is, yeah, maybe they're just becoming a darling and really increasing their footprint and all this good stuff. And there's just people trying to dig around.
Yeah.
Doubting the numbers, doubting the success, whatever it is. So tread lightly, I'd say, and figure out what happened.
Yeah. And my question would be, you know, when the negative news broke, was there any actions taken to address, you know, the negative press? If there is, then it really is time to move on. But it wasn't addressed and the company was working on some kind of solution, or there has been new developments in the past few weeks, then maybe it's worth doing like a brief statement. But again, I would probably tuck it into a broader context, more news about the company that's positive. So you can still address it and kind of protect the brand value, but at the same time, giving yourself an opportunity to shift the narrative to a more positive direction that you want to take.
Mm-hmm. Last question for us today, Amy. Here we go. Dear Banff, our new CEO comes from a really impressive background with multiple IPOs under his belt. What's the best way to utilize him? He's pretty shy about his accomplishments and fears being showy in any way. So this is the classic, I have a baller, let's say even genius leader here at my disposal, but they don't want to be highlighted. They don't want to be put forward. Have you had this before, Amy?
Yes, but I think there are fundamental differences between being a media darling for your personal brand versus being the voice of the company and the steward of the company's reputation.
Quite true.
I think the former means the CEO is really always trying to promote himself or, yeah, you know, trying, yeah, to pursue soft news about themselves, like a Vanity Fair story or something.
Yeah.
The latter is truly communicating very accurate information about the company, the value of the business to the general public. And that is an essential part of a CEO responsibilities. Your reputation is very much linked to the company's reputation.
Yep.
How you say it, how you deliver the message is such an important job. And when reporters and the general public look for stories or information, they look to the chief of the company as their source of information. So I think it's important to make that distinction obvious to the CEO and tell him that, you know, what we're trying to do here is really have you out there in media to contribute to the reputation of the company, which is such an important long-term asset to the business value. I think that's kind of like step one, mm-hmm, in convincing him and getting him to start being more comfortable of being out there and talking with media.
Yeah, I think sometimes folks will think, leaders will think, oh, but I don't want to be that Vanity Fair thing or the Weekend Wall Street Journal, what did I drink with my tea, dog's name pieces, you know, that type of press to what you're alluding to on that like personal persona stuff. And there's quite a big difference with, well, you're the spokesperson for the company. You have to be the channel in which its reputation, its brand, its mission is conveyed.
Yeah.
That's what your role is.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, a huge distinction for someone who's, you know, and we've seen this a lot of times. I'm sure you have, Amy, of like the Silicon Valley CEO. They're in the science rooms. They're in the labs. They don't want to be on stage, or they don't want to be on 16 podcasts a week or whatever, because they just want to build their thing or be in the lab or solve whatever problem. And so if you convey it in this sense, to your point of, you know, this, you're the vehicle in which we get the mission across. And you don't have to be the only one, by the way. It could be other people in the C-suite. There's maybe some other people you could tap, but that's part of your job. And that's just a function of your role. We don't need you to have a piece in Inc. magazine about what your favorite sock brand is or whatever.
Or your private jet.
Exactly. Or what do you eat for breakfast? Smoothies or something. Yeah, exactly. And I think that's what gets the CEOs who kind of like are bristled by this. They think of that. They think of more like, unfortunately, like the Elon Musk of the world, who just, you know, I'm going to tell you my favorite cereal brand, and that's going to be a headline in USA Today.
Yeah, exactly. And I think for this listener, he or she was asking how to utilize him. I think the way to position his past accomplishments is to say that he's such a strong industry veteran who have led so many high growth organizations to success. So even just him joining this current company is a validation of the company, because he sees something in this company and the potential where the company could go. So I think I would position his past accomplishments in relation to the company's value and growth trajectory. Mm-hmm. And always kind of position him as an industry expert and talk about, you know, market insights or industry trends, rather than have him just talk about his accomplishments. And I think that's where the CEO gets a little bit stuck. And that's when he was like, I don't want to talk too much about my past work experience or IPOs. You know, it's in the past. But tell him that, yes, we're going to focus on the present and the future, but utilizing the experience and background that you have built for yourself and what you're bringing to the table.
And that's probably why this person now is at the table, because of that experience. The other thing too with this is, and perhaps this is a good thing to utilize here, this is an assumption, but okay, this isn't the founder of the company. It's a new CEO coming from the outside, and folks who come into roles that are from the outside, what we were talking about earlier, like that executive operator versus the founder who then passes the baton when it gets to a size they can't do. There's very few examples of people who are the founder and still remain to be the CEO when the company gets hundreds and hundreds of employees. Mark Zuckerberg being probably like one of the most famous ones. Like, he's still there. So with this, again, part of the role, and it's not your founder story, it's not your legacy story or whatever. You're just there to be the spokesperson. Great. And probably if there's any goals, if there's usually someone like this who's coming under with like, yeah, you got a multiple IPOs under your belt, that's probably where the company's going, or it's probably trying to get acquired, something like that. Hey, that's just a benefit. So we don't have to tell your whole narrative and your whole background, but that's probably part of the goals of the overall company. So again, like you're saying, let's talk about present, let's talk about future, and we go from there.
Exactly. I think it's really about letting the CEO see the roadmap and how that's fitting to the overall picture of the company, and not just, you know, building his profile. I think some CEOs do fear that, you know, they get more famous than their companies, and people are going to say, wow, he's such a, you know, attention seeker. And that's why, if anything goes wrong with the company, they're like, well, that's why.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Well, Amy, thank you for being on for today, because we covered all the questions, at least all the disasters for today.
This is great. I really enjoy being on the program. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to Dear Banff, the advice podcast for PR and marketing pros like you. Our show is created by BAM, a PR and marketing agency headquartered in San Diego and New York City. The music you're enjoying today was composed by Tiffany Dizon, produced by Daniel Kessner, and played by San Diego Symphony's Art of Alon. Thank you to our podcast production team at Citizen Recording. If you have a tough PR and marketing question you'd like us to answer, please write to us at bamtheagency.com/Dear Banff. Don't forget the F. We'll be back next Monday with another episode of Dear Banff. Until then.